Hello, my name is Michael Paul, and I am with Texas Instruments. I support the Power Over Ethernet team as an applications engineer. I specialize in the powered devices side. In today's training, we will be going over Power Over Ethernet power delivery designs, also known as PoE PDs. Today, we will discuss the key design considerations before beginning a schematic. This training video series will cover the following topics. In this video, we will talk about defining the power level needed in the output voltage. With those two pieces of information, we can move to the second video where we will discuss topologies. The third video will cover O-ring options. This topic is also known as combining PoE with another power source, also known as adapter power or auxiliary power. From there, we will cover special considerations that may change the design. From there, we will discuss beyond BT power, which is a very unique case. Finally, we will end with finding the right TI design to base each new design off of. In today's video, we will first be discussing defining the power level needed for each design, and then we will discuss output voltage. Step one in the design procedure is to define the power level. Power over Ethernet power levels is actually more complicated than it might first appear. Before we begin, I want to define some terms that will be used throughout the rest of this presentation. First is power sourcing equipment, shortened to PSE. This is the equipment that sends power through an Ethernet cable. Next is powered device, or PD. This is the device that will receive the power through the Ethernet cable. The next thing I want to clear up is that the IEEE 802.3.BT standard came and it enabled us to send power over four pairs of Ethernet instead of just two. This standard is also backwards compatible, and that's why you see number of pairs and types with one or three, two or four. That is to account for that. Now that that's out of the way, let's talk about how power is defined for PoE. First, starting with the PSE, we define power that is power being sent directly after the PSE. So this is the available power right at the RJ45 port of the PSE. Now you will notice there's a difference between that power and the power at the PD. This is supposed to account for the power loss in the cable. Now, we write minimum power because there is a voltage range that the power sourcing equipment can send the power over. A lower voltage at the same power results in a higher current, which will result in higher power loss in the cable. Therefore, we define the power as a power minimum. Now that that's said, it is important to understand that for a powered device, the power listed here and as commonly talked about is the power available at the RJ45 port. That is the input power. These are the power levels that are defined within PoE. I want to be clear, this is not the power level for that is available to the load. Now that we have our power levels defined, we can go ahead and begin talking about how much power our design actually needs. First step is to discover how much power does my load need. This includes an MCU, it could include a motor, it can include an antenna, anything that the device is going to be powering, we need to be factored in and added together. From there, we can then calculate how much power is needed at the PD input. Now, as I said, there is going to be a DC-DC drop. Most designs move from the PoE input voltage down to a specific power rail. Now, even if the power is completely passed through and you have no DC-DC, there's still going to be some power loss because it is a PoE standard that requires the PD to have a hot swap fed. For now, we're just going to assume a 90% DC-DC drop. Of course, that is going to be heavily dependent on future design choices, but for now, it'll work. Once we have how much power we need at the PD input, we can then define what type or class does our device fall under. That'll help us pick an IC to support the required type or class level. Now, I would like to address a common misconception about class selection. In many of TI's PD datasheets, this table is presented, and I will admit, the wording is a bit confusing, so I'd like to take the time to clear it up. In the first left-hand column, we have the different classes listed, 0 to 4. Then, in the next two columns, we define this as power AT for the AT standard, in this particular case, and for the power device at the power interface. So power AT PD PI. From below that, we put a minimum power and a maximum power for each class. Now, what is misleading about this is it appears to say that, for example, class 2 must draw at least 3.84 watts and up to 6.49 watts. Now, that is not true. In PoE, there is no minimum power draw that we have to meet. The only thing that's minimum that we need is the MPS, or maintain power signature signal. This is defined in the PoE standard. We talk about this more in our PoE one-on-one training, but the basics of it is you need to draw about 10 milliamps of current for the PSE to continue to send power to our device. Other than that, there is no minimum power draw for our class. What that means is you can have a class 4, which draws a maximum of 25.5 watts, and you can have it be in a idle state at 1 watt for as long as you like, as long as it draws MPS current. So what this is trying to say is, based on our last slide, when we calculated how much power we need at the input, the RJ45, or here we call it the power interface, PI, if it falls within the bounds of a minimum of 3.84 or a maximum of 6.49, then it is a class 2. Therefore, that's how this was written. However, it can create some confusion. So hopefully this section can get cleared up. Now that we have our power level defined, then we can discuss the output voltage requirement. For the output voltage, the first question we always ask is, what is the highest voltage rail needed for the load? Common examples are 5 volts and 12 volts, while I listed some other ones here. Many designs will actually have multiple output voltages needed for different devices. For example, some devices will run off 5 volts. They will also need 3.3 volts and 1 volt to power sensors and other GPIOs. In that case, we pick the highest voltage. For example, let's pick 5 volts. From there, we can use a point of load, a buck, or an LDO to get the 3.3 and 1 volt that we need. Here at TI, we would call that the output voltage is 5 volts, because that is the output voltage from the DC-DC converter that converts from the PoE range to this power rail. Now, it is possible to use a lower voltage and then boost the voltage up using a boost converter. And while that is a common practice, we typically advise to start with the highest voltage level and then step down. We do this because these step-down converters can be lower cost, easy to use, compact, and ready to go for systems such as this. We have many reference designs here at TI that go from 5 to 3.3. So this is typically why we design in this way. However, for our discussion, the voltage stops at what is the output of the DC-DC converter. So we ask ourselves that question, and that gives us the answer to an output voltage.